The Hudson Library and Historical Society presents music lecturer, independent music producer, and Beatles expert, Jacob Trombetta, with Here, There, and Everywhere, tracing the cultural impact of the Beatles, at the Hudson Library's Blood Meeting Room on February 11, 2014. Now, here's Jacob Trombetta.
Hello. Hi.
Hi.
Welcome to the second event in our Beatles Week series. Very excited to have Jacob tonight, but I have a couple of administrative items to take care of first. Let's see here. If you notice on your seat, there are some program evaluations. If you could fill those out at the end of the program, that'd be very helpful. We always appreciate your input on our programs. And also, I wanted to plug a couple other Beatles Week events. Tomorrow evening, we've got another lecture. It's entitled Revolution, the Beatles and 60s Counterculture, and that's with historian Mike Goodenough. And then Thursday evening at 7 o'clock, we'll be showing a documentary called Good Old Frida. And that is an award-winning documentary told from the viewpoint of the band's long-term friend and secretary, Frida Kelly. So if you come out for those will be great. And now for tonight's speaker. He earned an MS in Applied Mathematics and a BA in Music, Film, and Mathematics from the University of Akron. His current research and lecture topics focus on 20th century composers and their cultural and artistic contributions. He lectured at the Akron Art Museum during their 2013 Real Surreal exhibition on surrealism, and has also lectured at the University of Akron on electronic music, media art, and mathematics. In addition to working as a software engineer, he runs the independent music label Discrete Spectrum and is a creative consultant for Akron Film and Pixel. Presenting his lecture, Here, There, and Everywhere, Tracing the Cultural Impact of the Beatles, Jacob Trombetta.
Thanks, Katie. Thank you, Katie. And I'd like to thank the Hudson Library for putting on this event. And I'd really like to thank everybody here for coming out tonight. So I'll just get right into it. And we're going to be talking about the Beatles and their cultural influence. Now, first I want to answer, like, what draws me to the Beatles? Because if you think about it, how do you talk about the Beatles? There's so much myth and legends surrounding them. And we all experienced and grew up knowing of the Beatles. Now, when I think of the Beatles, I think about their music. I think about their songs, the way they sound to me, because I play music. I'm a musician myself. So tonight, I'm going to focus on, like, why are the Beatles still important to us? And my thought is because of the music. Now, quick question. What was Nielsen SoundScan's best-selling album of the decade from 2000 to 2010?
Beatles 1.
Now, this is crazy. I mean, how many years ago did they release these songs? And it's the number one selling CD. Now, they're the second largest selling band of all time. Anybody know who the first largest selling artist of all time is? Garth Brooks. Now, another interesting thing, think about this. In 1966, after John said they're more popular than Jesus, we're burning their albums, but Pope Benedict XVI in 2008, his papal newspaper, had this to say about the Beatles. It's true they live dissolute and uninhibited lives, but listening to their songs, all of this seems distant and meaningless. Their beautiful melodies, which changed forever pop music and still give us emotions, live on like precious jewels. Now, if you think about this, it's not the haircuts. You remember the haircuts. Sure, you remember John Lennon's glasses. When you see those, don't you think John Lennon glasses? Pointy shoes, you know, how they looked different periods. But I really like this. I love that they live on like precious jewels, and that's why I think we still talk about Beatles music. Now, what are the Beatles up to today? They earned a combined $71 million in 2013. So the person who earned the most is Paul, but the John Lennon estate earned, I believe, $12 million just from song royalties. Ringo earned $6 million. But combined total, $71 million. Now, these are funny. They have 38 million Facebook likes. That's like Barack Obama has about the same. 2 million Twitter followers. So this Twitter, Facebook, they came around way after the Beatles were, you know, done being the Beatles. In the past 3 months, they've had 25 million YouTube views. So this is their videos that have their songs on it. And they had 2.7 million Wikipedia page views. So what is with it? Why? What draws us back to the Beatles all the time? Now, in the liner notes from the 1964 Beatles album, Beatles for Sale, it had, "The kids of AD 2000 will draw from the music much of the same sense of well-being and warmth as we do today. For the magic of the Beatles is, I suspect, timeless and ageless. It has broken all frontiers and barriers. It has cut through differences of race, age, and class. It is adored by the world." Now, if you think about this, this is my whole point I want to make, is what it's these songs that it's broken all frontiers and barriers. These songs have been, there's a Gregorian chant, Beatles, sheet music and recording. There's Rasta Beatles music. Like, there's jazz Beatles music. Now, the Beatles have been embraced by every single genre, and unlike any other artist. But now what I'm going to do is go back and do a little history. Now, this is very early Beatles, when they were the Quarrymen, and you see Paul, John, and George. They were playing skiffle music. They were really inspired by people like Elvis. And Stuart Sutcliffe joined the band. He was, he always looks like the coolest one to me. But he actually was the one that suggested they call the band the Beatles. And they ended up being the Silver Beatles. And he was a terrible bass player. Awful. And he ended up staying on, living in Germany, and leaving the band, and then ended up dying at 21 of a brain aneurysm. Now, they had drummer Pete Best. Now, Pete Best was their drummer through their early years. So, their early years, they went, this is the top 10 club in Hamburg, West Germany, 1961. Now, this is the third club they played at in Germany. So if you guys are familiar with the story, they got hired to play basically strip clubs. And they would go, and they'd start playing, and they wouldn't be allowed to stop for the next 8 hours. So think about it. You're out there, you're playing 8 to 10 hour nights, and you're playing rock music. You're playing, because you have to get everybody dancing. Now this is great, because what they learned in this time was they had to learn all the hits. They had to play the hits. And if you had to play the hits for 8 hours, what do? You learn. Like, it becomes part of your DNA. Like, what makes an awesome Elvis song? You just keep playing that for 8 hours for a year every day, and you'll know. Now, they came back. And this is a picture, well, this isn't a picture from their first gig, but their first gig at the Cavern Club was on February 9th, 1961. Now, this is ironic because this is 3 years before they're on the Ed Sullivan Show. They got paid, anybody want to take a guess at how much they got paid for their first show at the Cavern Club? Just about £5. And, you know, 3 years later, they got paid $10,000 to appear on the Ed Sullivan Show. So, what a difference a couple years makes. Now, by this time, they were playing Liverpool. They were getting huge, like really big in Liverpool. And Brian Epstein came to the Cavern Club and saw them performing, and he loved them. And some say he loved them because Brian Epstein was a gay male. So there's these four young, good-looking rock and rollers playing music, and everybody's into it. But he saw potential in them, which is great. They ended up, towards the end of their 292 gigs that they played at the Cavern Club, they had their band. Now, the story is Pete Best, their drummer, who was their drummer from like the 8 to 10 hour days for years, they finally got signed and they kicked Pete Best out very unceremoniously. So Pete Best is still alive. Pete Best has a Beatles early years tribute band, which is kind of crazy. I just wonder how you feel as Pete Best to be kicked out of that band right before they go, it just go crazy. So, Beatles go in. Brian Epstein gets them they go to Decca Records. They have an audition. So they audition, and Decca Records says, no, we don't need you. We're going to take this other band. Do you know who the other band is? Nope, no one does. So they go over to, they go over and see George Martin, and they play some songs. And George Martin's like, hey, I think we could do something with you guys. So let's make a record. So they go, and they make Love Me Do. So it's the first song they recorded with Brian. Interesting, Ringo doesn't play drums on this. Ringo showed up, and George Martin had found a different drummer to play. So they forced Ringo just to play tambourine on this song. So they released this song to the UK market, and it does okay. It doesn't go crazy. They didn't have their hit yet. So, back working in the studio, and they come up with Please Please Me. It's released January 11th, 1963. Now, Please Please Me is an excellent example of what the Beatles did to pop music. They perfected pop music. We are still, I try to write pop songs. And the Beatles literally were like the Bach of pop music. And what it is John Lennon had this thing he called the middle eight. I have a couple theories on why they're great. One is John Lennon's middle eight. Paul called it the middle eight too. And this is the bridge of the song. You know how songs start out with a verse. So you have, you know, like, deep down in Louisiana, across the New Orleans, da-na-na. And then you have the chorus, like, go, go, da-na-na-na, go, Johnny, go, 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 da-na-na-na. Then there's a bridge. Now, that's the middle eight. And this is where the song sort of shifts before it goes back into the big chorus. Now, usually, like, a lot of, like, some of the most popular songs in 1963 in America, you know, they didn't really have this middle eight section, this bridge, and they would just have a little instrument, like a solo part to it. So that's one thing. And I'm going to play Please Please Me, and I'll point out this middle eight. Another thing that took me a while to realize is how incredible and how important Paul McCartney's bass lines are to all the Beatles songs. Now, when I first started listening to the Beatles, you hear the melodies, you hear the singing, which is incredible. They have excellent vocal melodies, vocal harmonies. But you listen, and Paul doesn't play, bass up until now is either boom, 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 or like bum, 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 bum. But Paul actually plays melodies on the bass. And I think that draws us in too. And that brings me to my third reason why the Beatles perfected the pop song. I believe, it's my theory, that we are drawn to songs that have multiple singers on it, or even harmonies. So when you're listening to a song on the radio, do you know how, like, when the chorus comes in, it sounds like more people are singing it? Like, the voice sounds bigger? I think that when we hear people singing together in harmony, it makes us want to sing too. And I think this, like, desire to sing with the people, like, with the song, is what makes things catchy and makes you want to hold on to it. So you had these harmonies, but then you also had this bass playing essentially another harmony with the vocals. So this was their first single, Please Please Me, that was a hit in the UK. So we have the intro. Go right into first verse. Notice both Paul and John are singing together, so it draws you in. Now they go right to the chorus. Got that first verse and chorus. Next verse. Here comes the middle eight. Nothing wasted in that song. Everything had every verse, every chorus, memorable. You want to say, like, come on, come on. You already knew the song. By the second verse, you knew it. Like, you could sing along to it with John and Paul. And then that middle eight, that bridge, and I think this is what just keeps us, just hooks us. We're just into that sound. Now, UK, huge hit. Released it in America. Crickets. Nothing. Now, by this time, or at this point, no British band had come over to America successfully. They would come over. They'd be huge in Britain. They'd come over to America and they would just tank. They would do really bad. So the Beatles did not want to go over to America until they had a hit. And I thought this was interesting too. Their I Want to Hold Your Hand, it's right here and here, was leaked on December 26th, 1963. And this was their first US hit. Now when I heard this, now you hear leaked all the time. You know, music's digital. But I can't wrap my head around. Basically, DJs got the 45 before Capitol Records wanted them to have the 45, and they started playing it, and people were like, yeah, this rules. So I would like to think that they were the first band to have a leaked album. But I don't know if that's true. So, great, huge hit in the US. They were in Paris when they found out. George Martin called them. He's like, hey, you guys have a hit? And they're like, super, let's get to America. So the Beatles leave for America on February 7th, 1964. Now this was a huge trip. And this is one of my favorite photos from it. We've all seen the photos of them with, you know, the crowds of people But I love that they still had to get their bags and go through customs. So they did feel the pain, even though, you know, everybody knew who they were. Now, the reason they were coming over is they were going to play 3 shows for Ed Sullivan. And they were getting paid, like I said earlier. Like, there's part of the Beatles myth is Ed Sullivan was at the JFK airport. And they're like, he's like, why are there so many people here? And they're like, oh, there's this band called the Beatles. And he's like, I want them for my show. I don't know if anybody heard that. That wasn't the case. Contract was signed. They were coming over, $10,000 in pocket, 3 shows. They show up, they do a press conference, and they are awesome at press conferences. Like, a reporter asks them, like, sing us a song. And they're all like, no, pay us money. Like, are you real? I don't know, touch me. Which is another distinct difference between, say, Elvis. Elvis would be like, you'd ask a question, and he'd be like, yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Like, no, sir. No, ma'am. So it was real like, but the Beatles were like these, I just, people weren't expecting that. It was like the crew cut era, you know, like everything was, like these guys were just so loose and their hair was crazy. Now, on February 9th, 1964, they play the Ed Sullivan Show. And this is the huge event that brings Beatles to America. And I was talking to my parents, and it's great, because both my parents, my mom, I only think listens to house music, like dance, like, and my dad just listens to the radio. And I asked them recently, like, where were you? And they're like, oh my God, I had to be, you know, like I was home in front of the TV and I watched this. And the next day I went out and bought the 45. Like, so it was a huge, huge event for us. And what you got to remember, this is a cool picture from that show. They played 5 songs. And I like to think, like, what did the person, like the plate spinner feel like after the Beatles played? But I like this empty stage. And like, if you think about this time, you know, like JFK had just been shot in December, like a couple months before this. And it was like this cultural, like right now in America, it was at this like boiling point, because you had these like different eras, or like this, like things needed to change. And the Beatles were there at the perfect time, where I've read interviews with people that say like the Beatles made it like other things were okay, like other ways to think were okay. And the Beatles sort of introduced them to these new ideas. And so it was perfect. It was, at this moment, it was perfect for the Beatles to come. Now, 2 events right now. The Ed Sullivan Show with the Beatles on February 9th, 1964, and the Super Bowl that they just played in February 2nd, 2014. Now, how many people watched the Super Bowl? And then how many people went out and drove somewhere when the Super Bowl was on? Anybody? Yeah, was it not like a ghost town? Like it was. So now let's think about that. Ed Sullivan Show had 73 million U.S. viewers for the Beatles. This last football, the Super Bowl, had 111.5 million U.S. viewers. So there were more U.S. viewers for the Super Bowl, but there were more people. So the population of the United States was 192 million when the Beatles played, and it's 317 million roughly now. So what that means is 38% of U.S. citizens watched the Beatles play, while 35% watched the Super Bowl, 35%. Now, it kind of puts it in context of like how big of an event this was. Like, how big was the hype for the Super Bowl? You know, like, how much was it on TV? And then it's kind of neat to just be reminded, like, wow, more people watched the Beatles. percentage-wise. Now, they play. They play their five songs. And what did the press think? Televised Beatlemania appears to be fine mass placebo, a fad. New York Times. A magic act that owed less to Britain than to Barnum apparently could not carry a tune across the Atlantic. Herald Tribune. I was appalled by the music, which did not appeal to me at all. Right to the point, Walter Cronkite. He later admitted that he said this because he hated their hair. But my favorite is Newsweek, whose issue came out with them on the cover, Bugs About the Beatles, and they pulled no punches. Visually, they are a nightmare. Tight, daintified, Edwardian beatnik suits and great pudding bowls of hair. Musically, they are a near disaster. Guitars and drums slamming out a merciless beat that does away with secondary rhythms, harmony, and melody. Their lyrics, punctuated by nutty shouts of yeah, 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 are a catastrophe, a preposterous farrago of Valentine card romantic sentiments. So the press didn't like them too much. But 2 months after they performed, they got these scathing reviews. The Billboard charts had them at position 1, position 2, position 3, position 4, and position 5. They had the top 5 songs in the United States. This has never happened before and will probably never happen again. So obviously people weren't reading these reviews. On top of that, notice I said the top hot 100. And this is just the first 10. They also had these songs in the top 100. So obviously this struck a chord. People were hearing these sounds, this music that they loved, and then it's these precious jewels of melodies are coming to us and speaking to us and letting us see the world in a different way, you know. And of course they had the hair, of course they had the suits, of course they had the shoes. And this all created, you know, this all influenced culture. But that's not what really speaks to us as much today. Now, from another thing the Beatles are sort of credited with, for better or worse, are the first band to do music videos. Now, Richard Lester, he made A Hard Day's Night, and this was like the first, MTV ended up writing a letter to Richard Lester saying, you were the father of music videos. So if you think about it, one of the highest genres of videos on YouTube are music videos. So it's like this sprang up, like this idea of like, we can have the kids, you know, not just playing a performance, but like running around, acting goofy, running through a field, and people will watch this and connect with them, and we still see it today. Interesting side note, remember the first chord? How this starts out, this movie and this album? Think about that. Who starts an album like that? Now it's funny, recently there was a mathematician, I think he's from Canada, and he did spectral analysis on this chord. Because he wanted to find out, what instruments are these? Okay, so it's like 12-string guitar, maybe. George did the 12-string. But how did you get that? So to do spectral analysis, you do this math on the musical signal. And it gives you the frequencies that make up the overtones of the musical notes. So he actually found out that there's a piano note in there too to get really high. So you have, you know, bass, two guitars, and then the mystery was the piano note. And it's great. They wrote about him in the Wall Street Journal. He got that that neat little caricature of his face in there for finding out what this chord was. This was in like 2008. I was really jealous of that because I'd love to have a caricature of me in the Wall Street. Now, let's think about other bands in the 60s at this time. Now, the big band, when we're talking about the Beatles, we talk about the Stones. Beatles versus Stones. You know, like, or which one's better? Did they have, you know, a rivalry or not? Did you know that the first Rolling Stones hit in the UK was written by the Beatles? I wanna be your lover, baby. I wanna be your man. Now, it's interesting to look at the timeline. So the Beatles were making these albums, and the Beatles, Please Please Me, was unheard of because Lennon and McCartney wrote most of the album. No one did this. You got your songs from like Tin Pan Alley, like those were your hits. And like Please Please Me, the only thing that changed with Please Please Me, it's interesting, they brought the song in and it was like a Roy Orbison song. Like, come on, come on, please, please. So, but George Martin was like, speed that up and we'll make, and then your album can be called Please Please Me. So they did. Now the Rolling Stones, right after the Beatles started doing this, they started getting, like, Mick Jagger and Keith Richards started writing more and more of their songs. But their first couple albums where they wrote most of the songs were, the Beatles would do an album and the Stones album would sound like the Beatles album right after that. But then the Stones went on to create amazing, amazing music of their own. But it's neat to think that, you know, they owed a lot to the Beatles, and I think they knew that, and they both fed off each other. So it's sort of weird to think who was better, who was worse. Another person is Bob Dylan. Now, when I think of the 60s, and even now after doing research, I think like the Beatles were perfect for the 60s. Like the Beatles summed up the 60s. But Bob Dylan was the man who 2 years before the Beatles were making these big albums, he was making his like folk out, like he knew like the times were changing, like Free Will and Bob Dylan. He was the one that, you know, canary in the coal mine. Interesting story, I Want to Hold Your Hand. Bob Dylan wanted to meet the Beatles, wanted to get, you know, get talk to him. Because he thought the line in I Want to Hold Your Hand, like, I can't hide, I can't hide. He thought the Beatles were singing, I get high, I get high. So Bob Dylan wanted to find out how they got a song saying, I get high on the radio. But I don't know other than that, after they met, if he was disappointed, but I'm sure they found a way past that. Another big band that we think of is the Beach Boys. Now the Beach Boys had the number two song of 1963. So the year before the Beatles, you know, became huge in America. And it was Surfing USA. So think about the Beach Boys songs now. They had many of the pop, like, guys singing together, harmonies. They had that middle eight section, but they would sort of do solos over it. But it's the when the Beatles came around, and especially their later albums, this is when the Beatles would do an album, and the Beach Boys would one-up that album. And then the Beatles would have to one-up that album, and it was great because they worked together to make awesome music that we still listen to today. You know, I still love the Beach Boys. Another person, interesting, Jimi Hendrix, loved the Beatles, really influenced by the Beatles, especially their later, you know, because the Beatles were really good at these like psychedelic guitar effects. They were allowed to go into the studio and experiment, and Jimi Hendrix loved this. And when you think of Hendrix compared to the Beatles, Hendrix was the guy that was like just crazy, like wall of sound. You don't really think of them together. Like Beatles are the pop band, tight, compact. But right after this album, Hard Day's Night, was released, or not Hard Day's, whoops. So we got Sgt. Pepper was released. And a week after its release, Jimi Hendrix opens his set with this song. So this like really spoke to Hendrix. But this album was the one album, if I got to pick, changed music forever. Now, this was the first album. Now, if you think about it, albums up till then, like Please Please Me, that album, You had like, I Want to Hold Your Hand, Love Me Do, Please Please Me. Great pop songs. They were released as singles. They were put together. There wasn't any coherent structure to the album. This is the album that made the album the art form. Like, the whole Sgt. Pepper album is the piece of art. Now, I love that the story, back to Paul's bass lines, which I've shared how much I've loved with you. He would do this awesome thing where he would play a basic bass part, but then he'd go back and just really try to make the most awesome melodic bass lines here. And this is interesting because they're starting to use, before now, they recorded Please Please Me as they just sat down with mics and they played Please Please Me a bunch of times until they got it. Here, they're doing overdubs, they're going into the studio, they're using effects, they're starting to experiment with all these different sounds, and this is speaking to everybody. And it's interesting that I would say probably, when I write music, I think in album form. Like, I don't think of, like, just songs, because it just seems so natural to this whole piece. But it's fascinating now that this right here, The Beatles, now on iTunes, is actually sort of dismantling their cultural legacy of Sgt. Pepper. Because what do you do on iTunes? You buy single songs. Now, it's interesting that that's a weird concept to us. I don't know if some of you may find it strange. And it's interesting that before the Beatles started making Sgt. Pepper, this would have been completely normal. You buy the 45, that's fine. You don't get the whole album. Like, I don't even know if Roy Orbison ever released an album that wasn't like the hits of Roy Orbison. It was just songs. But now it's kind of ironic that we're coming back, full circle, back to a time where we just get the songs as opposed to the album. Now, the Beatles, like I said, belong to the 60s. It's interesting, the Beatles broke up. Their last album came out in 1970. Now, if you think about the beginning of 1960, we needed a change. You know, you have, like I said, John F. Kennedy was shot. We had this like crew cut era. We were at this point where we're bottled up. And the Beatles were there, and it just opened us up to like all these different ideas, all these different bands. You know, like it was okay to listen to, it was okay to have these ideas. And then it's ironic that in December of 1969, Ultima happened, where Hell's Angels stabbed a guy. And this was, I find this, you know, Martin Luther King was shot, Robert Kennedy was shot towards the end of the decade. And now we have this concert with a band from the 60s, the Stones, that sort of ends, in my mind, it like bookends this time of incredible songwriting that and pop music. And like, look at all these possibilities that we have. Like, look at this great thing that we can do together. And then that's sort of like the realization, like, oh, we have this, but things aren't so beautiful. You know, like things, there's both sides to it. There's light and dark. And I love it. It's sort of meaningful to me that they ended in the 70s, because it's just they were always part of that time where it's discovery and excitement. You know, they're out like they end with, you know, All You Need Is Love. When I was 14, I thought the Beatles were from the future. Now, I didn't really think this, but I used to go around. It was really fun for me in high school to say, like, you know, time travel is possible. There were, I had a theory that John, Paul, and George were time travelers. Because what would I do as a musician? I would learn all the hits and then go back in time and record the hits before anybody else did. And everybody would sound like me because they were trying to write it and I would have the hit. So it was fun for me to say this, and Ringo was definitely not one of the time travelers. They picked him up at the end, which is fine. But if you could sort of think about this, like what made them so, like how did they innovate so quickly. Like, some of these albums came out 3 months after each other. Like, groundbreaking album. 3 months later, groundbreaking album. And it's because they could combine all the resources. They did all the hours of playing all the popular music. They knew that. It was part of their DNA. But what would happen is they would hear other music, and it would just become part of their music. So Karlheinz Stockhausen, a German composer, he was famous in the 50s, and this is the most listenable piece of music. Guess who loved this piece of music? Both John and Paul. Paul was the guy, actually, that would go around London to all these avant-garde concerts, which was awesome. Like, he would go to, he'd hear this and be like, man, this rules. And he's like, hey, I need to do music like this. Like, this, I hear this in my music. And this is where I think, like, my goal as a musician is to be able to hear this, be inspired by it, and then make the song he made from after hearing this and being inspired by this was Tomorrow Never Knows. It's incredible. You have the sitar, you have that drone, you have this beat. That seagull sound is the guitars sped up in reverse. And you hear, that's part of a Sibelius symphony. And what they did was they took tape loops at this time. So Karlheinz Stockhausen would do this. Paul needed to do this, so he made these tape loops of Sibelius symphonies. And they sat in the control room, and they had 6 tape loops. And what he'd do is he'd just point to different people, you know, like George Martin would do it, Jeff, I forget the engineer's name, you know, John, Ringo, and they'd turn it up. You get... Incredible, incredible. Like, another interesting note, any guys Mad Men fans? What was the song in Mad Men? It's about an ad agency from the like late 50s, and now they're getting into the 60s, and they're sort of showing how like out of touch the main character is, like this old boys group from the 50s. And guess what song they chose as the this is a song that sort of represents all this change? Tomorrow Never Knows. They ended up paying $250,000 to play this song. Now, I would like to thank everybody for listening to the talk, and I'll play this song because it's perfect for the ending. Cool. Thank you. So I don't know if anybody has any questions or comments. Yes.
I noticed when you showed the top 100 the Beatles took, the top 5 slots.
Yes.
Number one song, you had a red star next to it, and then the number 8 song was called the Shoot Shoot Song, and you had a star next to it. Did that get knocked out of number 1 the week before to number 8?
You know, I'm not sure. I think the star might be it was the first week on there, but I'm not positive.
Like the Beatles had, of course, number 1 song was star, but the only other song that had a star on it. That's the number 8 song, so I was wondering if it overcame it from number 1 all the way down to 8 then, and that's how they mark that. I don't know, just something I noticed.
Yeah, that's interesting. That's a good question. Yeah, I'm not sure. Yeah, I can. Told you. Oh. So...
Can't Buy Me Love is the one with a star, then the Shoop Shoop song is number 8, so...
Yeah, and it looks like... It had moved up the charts, so this one, Shoop Shoop Song, looked like it was at 3 weeks ago, 50, so maybe, I don't know, because it's not the jump, because this made a...
I think it means new to the top 10.
Ah, you're okay.
Yes. Like
that. But that doesn't make sense, because no, 10, yeah.
But all five of those songs, didn't they make it in on that first week for the first time, the five top five songs?
I'm not sure about that. Actually, interesting thing, one of my favorite things about Please Please Me was it was released in the U.S. and flopped, and then they released it again 2 years later, and it went to number one. Just kind of funny. Right. Yes?
How did the Beatles get aligned with Ravi Shankar? And what was the influence that Indian music had on other artists at that time?
That's interesting. That's a good question. I think the person that was introduced to Ravi Shankar first, I believe, was George. And I'm not sure. I think they were just looking at different religions. And I'm not actually sure how they actually got connected, because Ravi Shankar is the most famous sitar player. So I assume, like, with the resources you have, you find the best musician in that field. And this was, of course, like, you hear this. They were the first recorded use of Western music, like, with the sitar and these, those sort of instruments and tabla. And it's interesting because you still hear it today in different kinds of music. Like, if you think of the band Oasis, you know, it was just all Beatles songs, all, you know, like, you hear the same sort of influence. And even now, if you hear those, like, sitar, I think of the Beatles before I, you know, like, oh, they're doing what the Beatles did. So I don't know if that sort of answers it. Yes?
You made mention of the fact that you really love Paul's bass playing.
Yes.
When I listen to the Beatles, I don't think the songs would be as good without Ringo's drumming. I wondered what your opinion of his drumming was.
I agree with that as well. I think every part, what's so amazing about the Beatles is there was nothing lacking. And I feel like Ringo wasn't like, because he couldn't be that drummer. Like, he wasn't supposed to be that drummer. And it's actually funny. They said that they would joke around that Ringo was the second best drummer in the Beatles. And Paul was the best. But he was like the beat keeper. Like, you needed someone to keep that time. And that's what Ringo just had. Like, he was solid. And that's what the Beatles needed, that backbone to sort of go around all the melodies. So I think without Ringo, they couldn't have been the Beatles, you know? And you could probably say the same thing about, like, Charlie Watt, the Rolling Stones drummer. Like, that dude is just a machine. Like, he doesn't move. Like, I don't know if he's breathing. He just plays. But I think Ringo had more of a, like, definitely Ringo fill. Like, that sounded like a Ringo fill. But yes?
Yeah, I'm a great Beatles fan. I saw them in Cleveland Stadium in 66, the old Municipal Stadium. When they came out, I thought the stadium was going to collapse. I never heard. I mean, frankly, it was like the second coming. It was unbelievable. But two things. I remember I was 14 when Presley came out. Nobody ever saw anything like him. Nobody. I mean, Jerry Lee Lewis, yeah. Jerry Lee Lewis came a little after Presley. And I was wondering what your thoughts were about Presley being a groundbreaker, because if you look at Presley, they say, take Michael Jackson, would have to have 9 years of hits to equal what Presley did. And I'm not picking Presley over the Beatles, because I'm very much a Beatles fan, but I also like Presley. And I was old enough to know, I mean, people never saw anything like him before, with the hair and the snare and the moves. And one last thing, I had a friend who was in the army in Germany, near Hamburg, and a buddy of his came back to the barracks and said, hey, there's a great band over here playing in town in Hamburg, you know, you gotta go see him. He said, who are they? He says, the Beatles. He said, the only reason he didn't go is because he thought it was a stupid name, because nobody had heard of it. And to this day, he regrets it. But I still have the ticket. I have it framed from the thing. But I was wondering what your impression was of Presley and people like Jerry Lee Lewis, Little Richard, busting through, because I know the Beatles were influenced by them as well.
So that's a great point. So Presley, I love him too. And the Beatles definitely loved him. Like, the Beatles at the beginning were Elvis Presley, Buddy Holly clones. That's what they wanted to be like. And it's interesting, like, you don't they grew out of that and they sort of expanded because Presley went to war. Buddy Holly had died, and then Ed Sullivan. Then they played on Ed Sullivan. So it was sort of like a passing of the torch with these bands. And I feel like Presley's legacy was this, like, you know, like, it's incredible. And he was, you know, he would have that middle eight, he would have odd times, and I feel like he's just as important to both the Beatles and culture now as the Beatles were. So it's almost like you can't choose it. And then for your second question, or the second comment you made, it's interesting because the reason they chose the Beatles was because of the crickets, the Buddy Holly thing, which I thought was interesting. So that's what Stuart Sutcliffe came up with. But yeah.
Well, just wanted to add to that. That friend of mine was in the Army, was after he got out of college, he was working on his master's and he was in Tahoe bartending, and Presley was playing there. And he used to pass the bar, and he'd have like three bodyguards in front, three in back, and 10 girls following him. Out to the stage, back off the stage. And he was getting off a shift, and he was standing next to the elevator, and here comes Presley. And the bodyguards were there, and the entourage of women were there, and he was there first, and Presley came up to the elevator, and he said to him, Elvis, hey, I really like your music. And he said, I was in the army like yourself with this such and such in Germany. And the bodyguard stepped in and pushed him aside and said, hey, just back off. And Elvis said, hey, man, hey, I want to talk to this guy. He said, you know, what outfit were you in? And they talked army for a half a minute waiting for the elevator. He ended up taking him up to the room.
Wow.
Take him up to the room and he said, hey, have whatever you want to drink and eat and all this. He said he never forgot it. The other thing is I saw Pete Best in 2007 at the Winchester. And it's funny that he said he played over 1,000 gigs with the Beatles. And then what was it? Three months before they came to the States, he was fired.
Yep. Very unceremoniously.
Very ironic. Here he is, what, 7-8 miles from the Hall of Fame, playing where I paid $10 to get in. I was 20 feet from him and got some great pictures of him playing. They said he was a heck of a drummer, and there were riots in Liverpool and Manchester when he was let go by Epstein for whatever reason there was. But I watched him play, and I don't know music, I can't play an instrument, but all he had was a little list of tunes he was going to play. He had a band with him. And it was amazing. He just played everything by memory. But it was so ironic that here he was, he missed the boat on that.
Yeah, that's one of the sad stories in rock.
I was wondering what your thoughts on Pete Best were. Because if you're ever having a bad day, think of Pete Best.
I know. Actually, that's sort of what my thought is. Like, however bad I think I have it, I could have been Pete Best. It's like the person at Decca that didn't sign the Beatles, the person that didn't invest in Apple. You know, like... Or just no matter what you do after that, it's like, oh, I'm the guy who didn't sign the Beatles. But you had a question earlier?
Could you go back to the Aero set?
The Aero, oh yes. The MC Aero set?
Right. That was the set that the director set up for the Beatles. I don't know if you know this.
No, I don't.
And when Ed Sullivan got there, he says, they don't need all those arrows. They know who they are. They'll be okay. And they just set them up with a plain.
Oh, with the blue. So this blue one?
Yeah. That was not.
Yeah. It's interesting.
I like that this show, one of the stories, Leonard Bernstein tried to get tickets for his daughters and couldn't get tickets. And he had just come from a lunch with the first lady. And I like that they're like, no luck. Composer Bernstein. Yes.
Do you think if John Lennon hadn't met Yoko Ono, they would have stayed together longer? The band, that is.
No. That's my theory is no, because at this point, I think that Paul was sort of like, you hear stories about Paul wanting to do this with the Beatles, and they wanted to do that. Like, he was telling Ringo, like, play this, Phil. You know, these are the songs, and he wrote most of the lion's share of the later album. I just think that it was like they did It's almost romantic that I think that they did their part. It was like cosmic that they were supposed to break up with Yoko or without Yoko. But that's just my opinion. You know, no one could really say. And it's neat to think of like the myth reality. You'll never know. And it's sort of, you know, it's fun to think about. Yes?
Back to the arrows.
Yes.
One more time. What are, in the middle arrow on the top, like at the 12 o'clock position, what are those two things that are in the arrow?
Oh, those,
are those like kettle drums or something? I can't tell somebody.
So this right here? Oh.
Above that.
Left.
Yeah, right in there.
Those are arrows cut into the arrows. Yeah.
Oh, and what was Ed Sullivan's network? That's another one.
Oh, shoot. That's a good question. I'm not sure. CBS. Thank you. Wasn't there only three networks at the time? Yeah. And then it, like... Yeah.
They said that for the rehearsal that they had two rehearsals in the afternoon, and that I think it was John's mic was acting up. And when they finally, and they had a group of about 100 people come into the studio for each of the first two rehearsals, and then of course they had it packed for the evening rehearsal, which was the TV show. And by that time they had the mic all worked out and so forth. But initially, in the first two shows, John's mic was acting up.
Oh, it didn't work.
Replace it. And that was on the news today when they were talking.
Really? Oh, that's interesting. I know too that George wasn't able to make the rehearsals because he was sick.
Strep throat.
Yeah.
They had a guy who worked at CBS fill in because he had a suit on that was similar to the Beatles. So if you watch that thing that was on CBS on Sunday, there was a Beatles show on for about 2 hours. Check it out. You can probably find it on CBS's website.
It's on again Wednesday.
Oh, great. So it's on again Wednesday on CBS. Any other questions or comments? I really appreciate you all for staying and talking and listening, so thank you.
Production facilities for this program were provided by Hudson Cable Television, your window to the community. If you have comments or questions on this or any HCTV program, please leave us an email message at hctv@hudson.oh.us or call us at 330-653-2500. We'd love to hear from you.